Amen. 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 Psalm 145, 13 says, "Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is trustworthy in all he promises and faithful in all that he does." So God, today, help us to be reminded that you are trustworthy. God, that no matter what the world around us looks like or the world inside us feels like, that you are still on your throne. God, that you are the one worthy of our trust. God, so help us to trust you this morning. God, help us to praise you and lift up your name simply because of who you are, not because of anything around us, but because of who you are, the God of the universe who is trustworthy in all he promises and faithful in all that he does. God, so we thank you for that this morning. Help us to see that. Help us to look at things through your word, not through our words. God, we love you. Help us to trust you more. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As we continue worshiping today, if you want to come alongside somebody and either pray with them or let them pray for you, or maybe you want to pray for them, in the back of the room is our prayer wall, and there are people that are willing and want to pray with you this morning. So if you've got anything that you want to pray about as we continue worshiping God simply for who he is, head back and let's pray this morning. Let's enter into this next song with a heart of prayer, remembering that God is faithful in all he promises and faithful in all that he does. Let's worship our trustworthy God.
Just to hear still, only right.
on, let's just sing out that out the chorus as a declaration of our heart. You guys are singing loud this morning, and it's amazing. So as we just sing that out, let's just let it be the loudest it's ever been. I will worship you for who you are.
I will worship you.
One more time.
Go deep.
church. Let's sing it together.
I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind me. Without a angel's army, he's always by my side. The one who reigns, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel army is always by my side.
Psalm 23 says this, says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff. They comfort me. Listen to this. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. So this morning, as we sing this, let's remember that our shepherd doesn't always just pluck us out of bad situations, but he does prepare a table for us in the midst of our enemies, whatever struggles we're going through. He prepares a table for us. He wants us to rest in his presence, even when it's in the middle of our enemies. That's what our God does for us. He doesn't always change a circumstance, but he gives us rest in who he is so that we can make it through that circumstance. So as we sing this today, let's declare it, not because if we declare it, it's going to happen, but let's declare it because it says right here in God's word that he will prepare a table before us in the midst of our enemy. We are at a table. That takes time. You're resting. You're not rushing while you're sitting at a table. And sometimes we just want to rush through the hard times in our life. And today, if you've just got things going on that are coming to mind as we're worshiping and as we're singing and as we're hearing this today, just know this, that God is with you. He is preparing a table for you in the midst of your enemies so that he gets all the glory, so that he gets all the attention in it, through it, and after it. So let's worship him like he deserves all the glory in it, through it, and after it. Let's prepare a table of worship. God set the table before us. Let's respond by worshiping him this morning, by resting in who he is, not in who we think he ought to be. So let's lift it up this morning.
And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands. I'm holding up to your promises. You are faithful.
Come on, he's faithful. Nothing formed against me.
Nothing formed against me shall stand.
Would you lift your hands as you sing?
You hold the whole world in your hands.
What are we holding on?
I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful.
Come one. And nothing formed
against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hand. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful.
Let's declare this together.
Thinking that kid that was like screaming while I was reading the scriptures, I was like, man, that's what we should all be doing when we hear truth like that. Like, what? We should be getting excited. We can learn from a lot from kids, man. Hey, listen, we are in this thing together, following Jesus. It's powerful to realize that. So let's take a minute and do that. Turn to someone around you. Just let them know, hey, we're in this together. You're not alone. Nobody in this place is alone this morning. So let's do that this morning.
All right, we're going to make our way back towards our seats this morning. As you do that, I want to welcome those online today. Thank you for joining us, part of our extended family. Those of you in the room, thanks for being here this morning. Getting up, going to church is a great, great way to start your day. So thank you for being with us here today. If it is like your first or second time here, thanks for coming and worshiping with us. In the back of the seat in front of you is what we call a communication card, or you can fill it out on our church app. Wherever you get apps, just look for Coastal Life Church, and it'll come right up there, and you can fill it out. We greatly appreciate that. If you're here with us doing it on paper form, you can drop it off at the Get Connected desk on your way out today. We greatly appreciate that. So just a couple of things to draw our attention to this morning. Number one, ladies, this is the last possible moment of your lives that you could buy a ticket for the retreat that's coming up this Friday and Saturday. So if you want to do that, make sure you get to the lobby afterwards. There are limited supply left, so make sure you grab those ladies this Friday and Saturday in Port St. Lucie. It's going to be awesome. And there are other tickets that are going on sale today as well. That is for our FAU, Florida Atlantic University game day on October 8th. And I think the tickets are only $5. Is that right? $5. You can't beat that, right? So some of you may know, some of you may not know, Pastor James is the chaplain of the Florida Atlantic University football team. And this is a great chance. It's a 3:30 kickoff to go down, have some fun, invite people to go with you.
But also, you get to hear from some of the players afterwards, which is really, really cool about what God's done in their lives. So carve out some time for that. It'll be awesome. And thirdly, I almost said secondly, but I can't count. Make sure you check in on Facebook, because so far, by checking in, every two check-ins provides a meal for a student in Haiti, and you guys have provided 92 meals so far this month, so it's awesome. Keep up the good work. Go ahead and check in at any point in the service today. And speaking of children, our children's ministry is awesome. I don't know if you guys know that, but Pastor Jeremy leads an incredible children's ministry here. And great, we know about it, like Sunday, great stuff happens Sundays. Like, you guys are here, your kids are there, it's awesome, they learn about God. But it even goes beyond that. And throughout the week, we have opportunities for people to help invest into the next generation. And Tuesday nights at the Awana Clubs, we need some help. And also, Wednesdays at Pinewood Elementary School, Pastor Jeremy leads a group called Kids Club on campus, and he could use a volunteer or two for that. So if you have an hour a week to give to the next generation, which isn't that much when you think about what's at stake for the next generation, if you've got a little bit of time, talk to him. Talk to him. There's no better investment that you can make into the lives of this next generation. So as we continue today, think about that. I'm going to invite our ushers forward as we take our offering today. And if it is your first time here, second time here, relax. We don't want you to give. Thanks for hanging out with us today. If this is home for you, this is worship. So let's worship God as we give, so that people can continue to hear about the gospel, be equipped, and then go out and engage the world around them. So let's pray as we get ready to worship God. God, today we just are so grateful for who you are. God, we thank you that you are trustworthy in all that you do. God, I pray that you would help us to see that today, that you would speak to us through your word. God, I pray that you would show us how to trust you more. God, and I pray that as we worship today through giving, that it would be an act of trust, that we'd give it to you cheerfully, God, and we would honor you. God, that it wouldn't be a duty, but it would be worship. God, we thank you for blessing us. We thank you for what you've done. May these gifts that we give today be about you and your kingdom, God. May we never make it about us. God, we surrender them to you. We surrender this time to you. God, help us to hear what you want us to hear. And we pray this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. Tomorrow brings, it's not a day yet you have not seen us. So in all things be my life and bread. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less.
Trust in God. You know, when we think about trust, we've started talking about this truth of trusting in God last week. We talk about trusting in God when he doesn't move the mountains that we ask him to move. Trusting in God when he allows us to go into the valley that he allows us to walk through. Trusting in God when he allows storms to crash in on our life. Trusting in God when the blessings of life are incredible. Trusting in God when things are going just like we want them to in our family. Trusting in God. It's about this. It's about more than just having a phrase that's stamped on the currency of our money. It's about truly living in trust of God. Like you and me, do we live life trusting God? Last week, this was the question that we started with. I said this, that if we're going to be looking at this concept of in God we trust and living our life in trust of God, we need to put a framework around. We need to put a framework around all of this about how do we define trust? What does it really mean to trust, specifically to trust in God? And so we laid the framework of this definition of trust last week, that trust is this firm belief. Let's just stop there. It's a firm belief. When we think about something being a firm belief, it's this, it's the thing that grounds me. And when we talk about the word firm, it's like, it's the rock solid thing. It's the thing that anchors my life. It's the thing that anchors my soul. It's the rock that I stand on. It's the thing that keeps everything calm. It's the thing that I build everything of my life on. So it's this firm belief. But what is it that I'm believing in? It's this firm belief in the reliability, the truth, the ability, and the strength of God. It's this firm rock in my life that I'm standing on, the firm foundation that I'm building all my life on, that God is a reliable God. This verse that Pastor Chrisman read earlier, Psalm 145, it talks about this. It says that God is trustworthy in all he does and all he says. All that he does and all the promises that he makes, we can trust God in that, that he is reliable, that I can build my life on the fact that I believe that God is a reliable God. That if he says something, he means it. That if he promises something, I can hold on to it. That's the reliability. And this, not only that God is a reliable God, but I have this firm belief, this foundation, this rock that I stand on, that what God says is true. It's this firm belief in truth. That when God says something, I can believe him because there's truth to that. It's this rock, this foundation that I stand on, this thing that I build my entire life on, that God has the ability and the strength to do anything that he chooses to do. That he has the ability and the strength to help me make it through that storm of life, through that struggle in my family, through that thing that we're facing, that turmoil, that storm, that valley. That he has the ability and the strength to change things in my life. That he has the ability and the strength to maybe not choose to change those things, but to strengthen me and help me through it. It's this firm thing, this rock that I stand on, this foundation that I build my life on. A firm belief that God is reliable, that God is truth, and God has the ability and the strength to do what he says that he's going to do. We're looking through the book of Genesis, and we're looking through the book of Genesis and people that we find their story and God's story. All throughout this book, we're going to look at different people that we're going to look at their life and see how the trust of God was played out in their life. Sometimes they fully trusted God. Other times, they did not fully trust God. And I think we can learn from both. We can learn from the models and the examples of people who just lived their life in this complete dependence upon the reliability, the truth, ability, and the strength of God. But I think we can also learn from people who necessarily in a certain situation or even in a season of life did not hold on to and did not stand upon the truth that God is reliable. They did not stand upon the truth that God is able. They did not stand upon the truth that God is strong. I think we can learn from both of them because I think a lot of us fit into this category a lot more than the other. I think a lot of us go through life and seasons of life and face circumstances of life that we ask a lot of questions. We doubt a lot of things. And maybe it's not even in our words that we doubt God. Maybe it's not even in our words that we question God, but it's in the actions of how we face the situations and circumstances of life. That if we look at our circumstances and we look at our actions in those circumstances, what we say is, I don't fully trust God in this. I think he needs a little help in this. I'm not sure he's got this. Noah, we find his story and God's story in Genesis chapter 6. So go ahead and grab your Bible and go to Genesis chapter 6. We find Noah's place in the story of God here in the beginnings. In Genesis chapter 6, here's what we find. We find Noah being a man who really is this wonderful, incredible example of a man who trusted God. He trusted God. He did exactly what God told him to do, in spite of the fact that there were some difficulties that came along with that. In spite of the fact that the assignment that God gave him was pretty an audacious assignment, a pretty kind of big, big thing that God asked him to do. Look at this. In Genesis chapter 6, I think what we begin to find about is a little bit who Noah is. The kind of man that Noah is. Look at Genesis chapter 6, there's some verse 9. It simply says this: these are the records of the generations of Noah. Then he goes on to say this: Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his time. Noah walked with God. Here's how God's word, here's how God describes Noah. He says Noah was a righteous man. He was a man who did right in his life. He was a man who sought out goodness, who sought out kindness, who sought out godliness. He did right. Literally, this is how God describes him. God describes him that Noah is a righteous man. Then he goes on to say this, that Noah is not only a righteous man, he is blameless in his time. Blameless in his time, in his culture, in the world that was around him, in all that was going on around him, which we'll later find out was a lot of godlessness. In the midst of all this godlessness, in the midst of a sinful culture and sinless world, Noah was a man that stood out as a man that was blameless. Blameless. He was a man of integrity. He was a man that was honest. He was a man that was truthful. He was a man that people looked at him and said, man, there's a guy who's doing life right. It says this, that God says he is righteous, but he is blameless. People looked at him and said, man, there's a guy who's doing it the right way. There's a guy that in his marriage, he's doing marriage in the right way. They would look at his family and say, man, his family, the way he's leading his kids, the way he's leading in his family, man, there's a man who's doing it the right way. Man, look at how he does business, how he interacts with people in the community, how he lives life in this community. There's a guy who does it the right way. I think if we were to all look at our life, there's probably at least one person that we look at their life and we would kind of look at them and go, man, there's a lady who's doing it right, who's doing life right. You guys can think of somebody like that? And the reality is this is how God describes Noah. He is righteous in the eyes of God. He is blameless in the eyes of people in his time and the people around him. Man, there's a guy who's doing it right. Why is this? Why is he called righteous? Why is he called blameless? I think it's because of what that third phrase says in that verse. Look back there. The verse says this. What does it say about Noah? He walked with God. He was a man who walked with God. He's a man who had an intimate connection with his Creator. He was a man that understood that God, as the creator of his life, the sustainer of his life, the one that's in charge of his life and this entire universe, he had this communion with him. He had this connection with him. He walked with God. We talk about the life. I mean, literally, he lived life with God. He spent time with God. Maybe he spent time with God in prayer. He spent time with God in worship. He literally, his life walked with God. And when he walked with God, guess what happened? These things began to shape him. He began to reflect the character of his Creator. He began to reflect the goodness of his God. He began to reflect the kindness of his God. He began to reflect the love of his God. He began to reflect the integrity of his God. He began to reflect the truthfulness of a God. He began to reflect that righteousness and the blamelessness that people would have around him. Why? Because he was walking with God. He reflected God's character. And in that, you know what he did? We know this, we begin to know this about the life of Noah, is that he taught his family to walk with God. He led his family well. He taught his kids, he taught his grandkids, he taught his generations of his family what it meant to walk with God. Doesn't mean that he did it perfectly. Doesn't mean that he didn't make mistakes. Doesn't mean that he didn't do stupid stuff, because he did. But if you look at the life and the legacy that he left, he taught his family what it meant to walk with God. I think this was so important because here's what you got to understand. As at the time that he is in God's story here, the world had become corrupt. Look at this next verse. Look at verse 11. This is how God describes the culture and the world that Noah is living in. Look at there in verse 11. It says, now the earth was corrupt in the sight of God, and the earth was filled with violence. God looked on the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way upon the earth. Then God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. And behold, I'm about to destroy them with the earth. This is how God described the culture that Noah was living in. God described the culture in the world as vile. It literally was this wind that mankind had turned away from God. Mankind had turned their back and turned away from their Creator. Culture and the world and mankind had become corrupt and had become evil. And you look at Noah and he says, look how Noah is described. In the midst of all this evil, in the midst of the sin all around him, in the midst of the corruption that's all around him, here has he described Noah, that Noah stood out in the midst of it. Noah stood out in the midst of that corruption, in the midst of that evil, in the midst of that violence, and he stood out as a man who was righteous, as a man who was blameless in the eyes of God. He literally stood out from all the world around him. God looks at this and says, look at how the world is now. He says, Noah, in your time, this is what the world's like. It's corrupt. It's evil. It's sinful. It's violent. It's vile. The world has turned their back on me. Mankind has turned their back away from me. In other words, this culture is godless. Does a pretty good job of describing our culture and our world around us today. Sinful, corrupt, evil, violent, godless. What he said about Noah says, Noah, you are standing out, even in the midst. You're not allowing that to influence you. You're not getting sucked in by that. You are standing out. You are standing out so much that God says you are righteous and you are blameless. I wonder about you and me. In the midst of the sinful world around us, in the midst of culture that is corrupt around us, in the midst of some of the godlessness that's around us, are you and I standing up and standing out as men and women of God? You see, God became so, his heart was so broken by the evil and the sinfulness of the world that he had created. He said, Noah, I'm about to destroy it all. There's judgment coming. Because of the sin, because of the corrupt and the evil, there's judgment that is coming upon my creation. Because God takes sin pretty seriously. So look what he says to Noah in verse 14. He just told him, I'm about to destroy all the flesh, all of mankind. I'm about to destroy the earth and everything that's on it. And in verse 14, he says, but here's what I want you to do, Noah. Verse 14, make for yourself an ark. Make an ark of gopher wood. You shall make the ark with rooms. You shall cover it inside and out with pitch. Then this is how you shall make it. The length of the ark, 300 cubits. Its breadth, 50 cubits. Its height, 30 cubits. You shall make a window for the ark and finish it to a cubit from the top and set the door of the ark in the side of it. And you shall make it with lower, second, and third decks. Behold, I am bringing the flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh in which is the breath of life from under heaven. Everything that is on this earth shall perish. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall enter the ark, you and your sons and your wives and your sons' wives with you. And of every living thing of all flesh you shall bring two of every kind into the ark. To keep them alive with you, they shall be male and female. Of the birds after their kind, and of the animals after their kind, and every creeping thing on the ground after its kind, two of every kind will come to you to keep them alive. As for you, take for yourselves some of all food which is edible, and gather it to yourself, and it shall be food for you and for them, talking about the animals. Verse 22, thus Noah did, according to all that God had commanded him, so he did. See, God gives him some instructions. He says, I'm giving you this warning. This warning is that judgment's about to come because of the sin of this world. But he says, I'm making a covenant with you. I'm making a covenant with you that I'm going to save you and spare you because I see you as righteous, because I see you as blameless. And God then gives him this instruction. So here's what I want you to do. Here's how you will be saved. Here's how you will be a place of refuge. You are going to build this ark. And he says, I want you to build this ark. And he tells him all the details that he needs to know. He says, here's what you're going to build it with. You're going to build it with gopher wood. He tells him exactly the materials to use. Then he tells him, not only the materials, but here's the size that it's going to be. You're going to make it this length, you're going to make it this width, and you're going to make it this height. And then he says, I'm going to tell you exactly even the layout of it. You're going to put some rooms in it, and you're going to make three different levels of it. And he said, literally, he gave him all the instructions and all the details, exactly how to do it. Exactly what he wanted to do. And then he says this, and I want you to understand not only how to do it, I'm going to tell you why you got to do this, because I am about to destroy this earth and everything that is sinful and everything that is corrupt and everything that is evil in it. So I've given you the how, and I've given you the why. And he says, here's what I want you to do. Not only is that how you're going to build it, but I want you to bring two of every kind of animal, two of every bird, two of every animal, two of every creeping thing, which is a little creepy there. It'd be like things, God, oh my God, you got to put that on because I ain't touching that snake. And I'm definitely not touching frogs. I don't like frogs at all. So God, that's got to go on its own. But he says, I want you to do that. Then he says this, I want you to gather food, everything that it's edible. I want you to get food for yourself, and I want you to get food for the animals, because that's how I'm going to provide. I'm going to take care of you. He laid out the whole plan, laid out how to build it, what it should look like, told him why, told him all the things he needed to do on the sides, bringing the animals in, bringing his family in, take care of the food. And I love verse 22, because after he gives him all these details, verse 22 says this, thus Noah did, according to all that God had commanded him, so he did. Some translations say this, so Noah did everything God told him. Everything. He did everything the way God told him. Why? Because he trusted that God knew what he was talking about. He didn't say, well, you know what? You know, that's a good idea, but, you know, I've done this before, and if I build like a fourth deck on there, it would give us like a sunning deck that would be nice to have. You know, we could have that over there. Or you know what, and if I've got three animals in case one of them happens to die while we're on this boat, at least we still have two. I mean, he didn't say, you know what, I know that the length of that's good, but if we went just a little bit longer, maybe a little bit wider, or maybe not quite as wide, you know what we do in life? God lays out a plan for us in life, and then we try to alter it. Because we think we've got some better insight than God does. And so we're like, God, that's a good start, God. But let me make a little adjustment right here. Noah just says, everything. According to what God commanded, he did. According to the instructions that God laid out, that's the way Noah did it. If we were to begin to trust God in life like that, begin to trust that when God shows us things and he lays out living for us, and he lays out way we do it, and why we should do it, and how we should do it, and if we just say, okay, I'm just going to do the way God told me to do it, that's the trust of Noah. So Noah does exactly what he tells him. He gathers up the gopher wood. He builds it exactly the way he said. He follows the instructions, and then we know, most of us understand the rest of the story. In Genesis chapter 7, the very next chapter, look at verse 1. If you were to look at those first 10 verses, here's what happens. God tells Noah this. All right, I want you to gather your family up, and I want you to get into the ark, and I want you to get there, and I'm going to close the door in the ark. And Noah's probably thinking, okay, so here it comes. Here comes this storm. Here comes this flood. Here it all comes. He goes, I want you to get your family. I want you to get into the ark. I'm going to close the door. And then I want you to sit there for 7 days. Can you imagine telling your wife, guys, all right, we're going to sit in this ark. And we're just going to sit here for 7 days. I mean, just sit. And that's literally what they had to do. Because you got to think about it. Literally, he says, I'm just going to sit here for 7 days. And look at verse 10. Look what verse 10 says. Verse 10 says, it came about after 7 days that the water of the flood came upon the earth. Noah and his family was in that ark for 7 days before anything began to happen. But he trusted God. In his trust, he was obedient to God. God said, get your family, get into the ark, go in there and wait. And that's exactly what he did. You know what you and I do a lot of times? God prepares something for us, and we're in the midst of it, and he says, okay, now just wait. And it may be God's timing when his hand begins to move and we begin to see things. But we want it right now, right here, right now. Fix this right now, God. Take me out of this right now. And what sometimes he says, I want you to wait in obedience. I want you to wait and trust that I've got this. And that my hand will begin to move things when it's time to move things. That's what Noah did. And then, on that seventh day, the rains began to fall from the heavens. The earth began to burst open in water. begin to come from the heart of the earth. Look at verse 12. It tells us this, that the rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. It rained and rained and rained for 40 days and 40 nights. Scriptures, if you read all of these chapters, it tells us that the earth burst open and waters began to pour out of the heart of the earth. We, in our modern day, have seen areas begin to get flooded. We've seen even recently cities and regions of communities be flooded. But it's nothing like what happened here. Because what began to happen for those 40 days and 40 nights, it was not just a city, it was not just an area, it was not just a region that began to be experienced the flood, it was the entire earth. Everything that God had created began to flood. For 40 days and 40 nights it rained and water came from the sky until it covered everything. Look at verse 20. In verse 20 it says this, the waters prevailed 15 cubits higher and the mountains were covered. I'm not talking about cars being covered. I'm not talking about homes being covered. I'm talking about the mountains of this earth. The entire earth is covered in this vast water. Verse 21, and all the flesh that moved on the earth perished. Birds and cattle and beasts and every swarming thing that swarms upon the earth and all mankind. Of all that was on the dry land, all in whose nostrils was the breath of the spirit of life died. Thus he blotted out every living thing that was upon the face of the land, from man to animals to creeping things and to birds of the sky. And they were blotted out from this earth, and only Noah was left, together with those that were with him in the ark. The water prevailed upon the earth 150 days. Everything faced the judgment of God. Everything perished. It says he blotted out everything, everything that represented evil, everything that represented the corruptness, everything that represented sin, everything that represented godlessness. He wiped it out. And then Noah and his family float around the ocean. And look at verse 3 of chapter 8. Verse 3 of chapter 8 says, the water receded steadily from the earth, and at the end of 150 days, the water decreased. In the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, the ark rested upon the mountains of Ararat. It says, for this enormous amount of time, after the storm was over, after the rain stopped, after the sun came out, Noah and his family still stayed out in the middle of this ocean just floating, kind of aimlessly, without control. They didn't have a motor on the ark. They didn't have any sails on the ark. They were just at the discretion of God. And if we read the full story, we begin to understand that he sent these birds and these different signs to figure out when it was safe. But God had them just floating around there. Have you ever felt like you're just floating around the middle of the ocean in the middle of nowhere? In life, have you ever felt like you were just out all by yourself? Have you ever felt in life that you're kind of just out on a boat in the middle of the ocean, floating around aimlessly? Sometimes that's good because you need to stop having control of your life and let God have control of your life. And sometimes he puts you out there for purpose, to teach you dependence upon him, to teach you to just trust him. But we like to have a lot of control in our life. We like to know where everything's going to fall. We like to do when we want to do. Noah and his family rested in the refuge of what God had provided them in that ark. And God brought them to dry land. See, here's some things that I see about the trust that Noah exhibited. First of all, he trusted in God in the face of the unknowns. Do you realize this? God had told him, hey, Noah, I am fed up. My heart is broken. I am fed up with all the godlessness and the sin of this earth. I'm about to destroy this earth. But I see you as righteous because you're a man who walked with me. So I'm going to provide a salvation for you in this ark. And I want you to build this massive boat. And this is what it's going to look like. Here's the materials you're going to use. Here's the dimensions. Here's the blueprint. Here's all it is. Do you realize Noah had never built an ark before? I don't know if you realize that. No one had built an ark before. God didn't say, hey, look at that over there. Use that as a model. There was a whole lot of unknowns. Where Noah could have said, well, where am I going to get that much gopher wood? How am I going to build something that big? Am I going to try to do that by myself? Do I get to recruit some people to help me? How am I? He had never seen such a thing. And the reality is there was all kinds of challenges and all kinds of obstacles in this job that God had asked him to do. I mean, how is he going to build an ark that's basically three stories high? How is he supposed to do this thing? I mean, he doesn't have any kind of equipment, nothing, no kind of construction. How is he going to do this? There's all kinds of obstacles, all kinds of challenges. You know, how about when God asks you and me to do something that we've never thought about before? How about when God asks you to stretch yourself outside of your comfort zone and do something for him before? We kind of have these thoughts like, well, I don't think I can accomplish that. This was a huge, audacious job that God gave Noah. And because he just trusted God, he didn't say, well, I don't think I can accomplish that. I don't think I can do that. I think you should ask somebody else to do that. A lot of times, that's your and my response. God, that's too uncomfortable for me. Whew, that's too big. I could never do something like that. God, I think you got the wrong person. And you know what he's saying? I'm just asking you to trust me. I know who I asked. I know why I asked. Just trust me. See, Noah's job was simple. Noah's job was to simply trust God, obey his commands, and leave the outcome up to God. And that's exactly what you and I have got to do. We've got to just simply trust God and in that trust, obey what he tells us to do, to obey his commands and then leave the outcome up to him. Whatever that big, audacious thing that he may be doing, asking you to do, that crazy thing. Because you realize that was another thing about Noah's trust, is he trusted in the face of ridicule. I mean, you got to look at the dimensions and the thing of this. Let's look at the actual size of this ark that he's asking about. It's like the size of 1.5 football fields. I mean, that's the length of this thing. You can imagine the height. It wasn't like he could just like hide it in his garage and kind of do it so no one could tell. I don't want anybody to know this crazy thing. This is crazy, God. I don't want anybody to know the kind of crazy stuff I'm doing for you. I mean, people would like walk by his trailer house and go, what is that? What? I mean, there was this sense of ridicule in his life. Why was he doing this crazy thing? He has gone off his rocker. He is nuts. He is such a fool. But you know, in the face of ridicule, in the face of what seemed to be foolish, he just trusted God. And when you and I live in trust of God, some people may see it as foolishness. Some of those people may be even people the closest to you, family. That when you're just trusting God, you're being obedient to him, your family may think you're foolish. Some of your closest friends may ridicule you and think you're crazy. But like Noah, it's just about us trusting and being obedient to what God asks us to do. You see, Noah's trust wasn't based upon him. Noah's trust wasn't this self-confidence. Noah's trust was based upon God. He had this certainty that he had heard from God. He was certain. He's like, the basis of my trust for God is I know that I heard from God and God told me to do this and this, and this is how I'm going to do it. You and I can have the certainty that we hear God, because God wants to give us guidance. God wants us to give us instruction from him. And we're not going to hear an audible voice of God speaking to you and me. But he's given us all the instructions and the guidance that we need in the scripture. When you begin to develop time of praying and communicating with your Creator in prayer, you know what? He begins to lay things on your heart. He begins to lay things on your mind, and he speaks to us. Noah, he was like, I can trust in God because I'm certain that I've heard from God. We can have that certainty. He had this assurance of God being present with him. Why? Because of what we learned about him in chapter 9, verse 6. Noah walked with God. So that he knew, no matter how crazy this thing God asked him to do was, God's with me in it. He's not asking me to go off and do something crazy all by myself. God is present with me. He had that intimate relationship with God. And in that intimate relationship with God, he had the courage to tackle anything that God asked of him. If in your life you will be a person that walks with God, I can tell you, you will have courage to tackle anything that he asked you to do. Man, that's my prayer in my life. My prayer in my life is that people would describe me as a man who walked with God. What about you? Well, people look at your life and say, man, there is a man who walked with God. There's a woman who walks with God. Maybe because they look at your marriage. They look at your family. They look at how you do business. They look at your life in the community and look and say, there's a person who walks with God. When you begin to walk with God, you can have this certainty, this assurance that God is with you in whatever he gives us. Noah had this clarity in God's instructions to him. He felt like he could trust God because he had clarity of what God had told him to do. Now, I understand what you're thinking right now. You know, but sometimes I don't have that clarity. I don't know what God wants me to do. And there's times that we have to spend seasons of prayer, seasons in the Word, seasons of fasting, just to see what God... But it's not because we're asking God to speak. It's because we're trying to tune our heart into what he's saying. See, he had very clear, do it this way, do it that way, and this is why. The how and the why, God gave it to him. And so many times in our life we say, well, I don't have the how from God. I don't have the why from God. But the reality is we do. Because we have the clarity of Scripture given to us. And the reality is how we need to live life is given to us right here. But the reality is we just don't pay attention to it very often. We just don't care to get the instructions from it. As a believer in Christ, we have been given the Holy Spirit to reside in us. And the Holy Spirit is in us to give us guidance, to give us instruction of how to live life. And in the Holy Spirit convicts us and prompts us and reminds us of things. But the reality is, we go through life going, I don't really know what God wants me to do. And the reality is, all we're doing is ignoring the Holy Spirit within us. Because the Holy Spirit is convicting you about something, but you just want to ignore that conviction. The Holy Spirit is prompting you to do something, but you're just trying to shush it out. The Holy Spirit is trying to remind us and remind you of truths about God. And the reality is, you just want to plug your ears in. And then we want to say, but I don't know what God wants from me. Yes, you do. You just don't want to listen to it. See, Noah had this ability to trust because he was secure in the future that God had promised him. Remember what he said, I'm about to destroy the earth, but I'm going to make a covenant with you. You can trust me. I've got you in my hand. I'm going to protect you. I'm going to save your life. Some of us know the full end of the story of Noah. God blessed Noah. Chapter 9 and verse 1, it says, God blessed Noah and his sons, and he said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And he goes on in verse 8. He says, and God spoke to Noah, to his sons, with him saying, now behold, I myself do establish my covenant, my promise with you, and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the cattle, and every beast of the earth that are with you. Verse 11, I establish my covenant with you, and all the flesh shall never again be cut off by the water of the flood. Neither there again be a flood to destroy the earth. God said, this is the sign of my covenant which I'm making between me and you, and every living creature that is with you, and for all successive generations. I set my bow, a rainbow, in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of a covenant, a promise between me and the earth. So he said, Noah, you can trust me because I've got your future in my hands. tells us we can trust him because he's got our future in his hands. You see, the flood shows us what God thinks about sin. Sin detests him. Sin breaks his heart. Sin deserves his judgment. But just like Noah got to experience the mercy and the grace of God when he offered him a place of salvation, a place of refuge in this ark. You and I, we are offered a place of refuge, a place of salvation, a spiritual salvation in the cross of Jesus Christ. Because our Creator gave up his Son, Jesus, to die a very cruel death on a cross. His death on the cross paid the price of your sins and my sins. His body was put in a tomb, and 3 days he rose again, victorious over those sins, victorious over death, able to bring you and me life, salvation. We can have that salvation. We can have that security. We can accept the mercy and the grace that God has offered you when you and I believe in the cross of Jesus Christ. When we accept that our sins is what put him there. That's the covenant, the promise that God made with us today. You can have eternal life. All of eternity in heaven with your Creator, if you would simply believe and accept that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, and that is where you find salvation. Have you ever entered into that covenant relationship with God through Jesus? And maybe you have. Maybe you're that believer in Jesus. But as a Christian, has God ever asked you to do something that seemed impossible? That seemed crazy? Would you have the faith of Noah? That trust that Noah exhibited in just being obedient to whatever God asked? And I don't know what that crazy, audacious, impossible thing that God may ask you to do is. Maybe it's to take that child into your home that just needs love. That child that doesn't have a family, to show them what family is all about. That child that needs someone to just love on them. And you're thinking, well, how could our family do that? We don't have time for that. How would that affect our family? Would you just trust God that He has you doing something for a purpose? Maybe the crazy, audacious thing that God would ask you to do is to give generously to something that would allow His work to be carried out. Maybe God laid something on your heart to say, you know what, you've got resources that I've given you, and I want you to give those so that my work can be done in this or in that. And some of your family say, well, that's foolish that you would do that. That's what God asked me to do. For some people, God asked them to move to the other side of the world to be the hands and feet of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Would you be willing to say, God, you want me to move to the other side of the world, I'll do it. But what if God was asking your kid to go to the other side of the world? Would you be willing to let go God, you can have them. They're yours already. What is the audacious, crazy thing that God may be asking you to trust Him in? Let's pray together. As we pray, maybe there's somebody here who needs to respond to the truth of the gospel. Noah was seen as righteous in the eyes of God. The way that you and I are seen as righteous in the eyes of God is nothing about what we've done, but all about what Jesus Christ did. And when we've come to a place to accept the gospel, to accept that the cross was for my salvation, it says that God looks at us through the Son. He looks at us through the cross. And when He looks at us through the cross, because we've accepted the cross in our life, we've accepted what Jesus did there, it says in that He sees us as righteous. So maybe today, in this moment, right now, where you're sitting, you need to surrender to the prompting of God in your life, to acknowledge that you are a sinner, and that you have the need of a Savior, and that Savior is Jesus Christ, His death and His resurrection. And if that's you right now, in your heart and your mind, you can talk to God. Acknowledge to Him right now that you're a sinner. Acknowledge to Him that you recognize that your sin had to be paid for. Tell Him, if you do, believe and accept that the death and resurrection of Jesus was the payment of your sins. And it's in Jesus that you find salvation. It's in Jesus that you accept His mercy and His grace. If that was you in that moment just now, that you accepted the gospel into your life, I would love to be able to celebrate that. In no other way other than just knowing and praising God. But if that was you, would you just have the courage to raise your hand just for a moment? No one's going to come to you. We're not going to ask you to stand up. Just, James, I want you to know that today I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior for my salvation. If that was you, just raise your hand for a moment and then you can put it back down. Thank you. Church, we can trust God, even in the crazy, impossible, audacious things that He asks us to do, because God is trustworthy. He is worthy of your and my trust. God, we praise You. We thank You for who You are. We thank You that we can hold on to You, that we can live life in full trust of You. Help us, God, to teach us what it means to be fully dependent and fully trusting You. Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Amen. This morning, if you are in here, it's because probably my fault. I don't think I hit the right button. Is it working now? Oh, there we go. Sorry. Got it. If you're in here this morning and anything you heard today was a prompt on your heart, you want to pray with somebody, please. Track one of us down. Stop at the Get Connected desk. We want to pray with you, whether it's you letting us know, hey, I just trusted in Jesus for the first time, or whether you've trusted Him for a long time and you know Him, but He's calling you to do something bigger than you feel like you can do on your own. You just want to pray about that. We are here to pray with you, to walk through life with you. Also, two things I want to remind you about on the way out. If you are helping with our Loving on the Schools initiative tomorrow, you've already been contacted, so don't forget. All the donuts and everything, they're already prepaid for, so please don't forget. They're prepaid for, so go get those and take them to the school that you signed up for. We greatly appreciate that, and just go and be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ. Love on the faculty of that school tomorrow. Let them know that we care about them. And secondly, 2 weeks from today, which, believe it or not, is October, another month, man, another one bites the dust. Another month is gone in the year. But what's cool about that is we're starting the month of October with a night of worship on Sunday night, October 2nd. Right here, we're going to have an incredible time of worship. The youth ministry is going to join in. You guys are going to join in. It's going to be awesome. So carve out some time Sunday night, October 2nd, for a night of worship. It's going to be an awesome, awesome night. It's always a great night when you lift up the name of the trustworthy God that we put our faith in. It's incredible. So be here. It's going to be great. Other than that, let me pray as we head out of here today. God, we want to thank you for loving us. God, we want to thank you for being trustworthy. Help us. God, help us to truly trust you with every decision that we make, to hear from you through your word, God, and to be obedient to your commands and the promptings of the Holy Spirit in our lives. God, I just pray that you would help us as a people, God, as families, as individuals, God, as friends, God, to walk through life together, God, seeking you out. God, that we'd encourage and inspire each other to follow you, not to follow each other, but to follow you. God, and we thank you for being faithful. We thank you in advance for being faithful to us. God, we love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys are awesome. God bless you. Have a great rest of your Sunday.
His hands, his feet, my Savior on that curve.